each one of you to spiritual doctors for holistic health. As we all know, this is an endeavor which was embarked, say, a year back by Dr. S. Ranjan and Dr. Sandeep Jodh, where they get doctors from all over the world who are doing a marvelous job of amalgamating spirituality with medicine. So they're getting the best out of both, and they are way ahead of times, and they have realized that this is the only way to save the planet and all of us. So each Sunday we are inviting doctors who are sharing their inestimable knowledge about their particular field and how they are using spirituality also to enhance their medical abilities. So today's guest is Dr. Richa Dhamija. She's a dentist by profession. And I would love to, I take immense pleasure in sharing a little about her. Dr. Dhamija is currently managing her clinic, which is called the House of Smiles in Saket, New Delhi, for the past 11 years. She is an ex-resident of LNJP Hospital, New Delhi, as well as AIMS, New Delhi. She has done her internship from Christian Dental College, Ludhiana. I would like to tell you a little more about her education. She has done her BDS from Bangalore University. Further to that, she has done a diploma in medical and dental hypnosis, which is very, very interesting and intriguing, from UK. She's a registered hypnotherapist. She is a general hypnotherapist standard council member in UK. She has done a postgraduate diploma, a certified therapist from Tasso Institute, Netherlands. Wow, this is really, really impressive. About her spiritual journey, I'm sure she would love to share it herself. She has well in time realized that to know oneself or to go deep within, one has to go on the spiritual journey also. She has been practicing Buddhism for the past 8 years and also doing the Kriya Yoga by the Ananda Sangha. She's an avid reader of the Osho, and she's also practicing Kundalini meditation. And her specialty is actually amalgamating spirituality with her dental abilities. She is conducting painless dental processes, which is really, really very, 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 very interesting, because we have all gone through hell when we go to a dentist. So Dr. Richa Dhamija, I hand over the stage to you. We would like to know more about your spiritual journey from you. Thank you so much, and welcome to our stage, ma'am. Yes, Dr. Richa. Yeah, I will just give you the spotlight. You are the co-host now.
Thank you, Dr. Bhatia.
Yeah. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, thanks. Greetings to all of you at Spiritual Doctors for Holistic Health. Thank you for giving me this wonderful opportunity to speak about a subject that is so close to my heart. And it's been my dream and mission to share.
Ma'am, you have two devices on, I think. Mm-hmm. Either we lost her. She was on two devices. She'll have to switch off one. तब तक डॉक्टर गगन जी आप बता सकते हैं आप हाउ यू बेटर एंड मोर अबाउट हर.
बिल्कुल, मैं डॉक्टर इच्छा से मिला था ओशो के एक प्रोग्राम में, और उनकी पर्सनैलिटी भी उनकी तरह बहुत चार्मिंग है. जब उन्होंने बताया कि हिप्नोथेरेपी से इतना कुछ हो सकता है, इवन पेनलेस तो एक्सट्रैक्शन हो सकती है विदाउट एनी गिविंग एनी एनेस्थीसिया, मुझे लगता है डॉक्टर इच्छा ज्वाइन कर गई हमारे साथ.
हाँ जी, she's there.
Okay.
Yeah. So greetings to all of you, spiritual doctors for holistic health. I think you have a wonderful forum going on, and I think I'm very lucky to have been invited aboard to speak about a subject that's so close to my heart. And so I've been a dentist for 26 years, and hypnotherapy sort of just chose me. And I would like to talk about, I would just like go with my screen sharing now, and I will take you through about whatever I've been up to and what hypnotherapy can do, how it can enhance all doctors' practice, clinicians as well as surgeons.
Yes, Dr. Icha.
I'm just going to share my screen. Yeah.
Yes.
Hi. Is my screen visible to all?
Yes, ma'am. All good.
Okay. Let's go forward with it. So before I to thank all my teachers, Unnath, who's been more than a teacher to me, Aisha Warrior, Mr. Yuvraj Kapadia, Mr. Nidra Handa, Dr. Mark Peters in Birmingham, UK, where I did my medical and dental hypnosis from. Clinical hypnotherapy is basically a very useful tool. Hypnosis in itself is just like an altered state of consciousness, but how we apply this natural phenomena in a very wide variety, we'll just get into that. So today we'll focus on the therapeutic application of this naturally occurring state. So I'm a practicing dentist with 26 years of work experience. And then for the past 6 years, I've been practicing hypnotherapy as well. It started with a dental hypnosis, and now to medical hypnosis. And then now we have another form. This is House of Smile. This is my team. The clinic was established in 2000. It's House of Smiles. My qualification in implantology. Then I did a diploma in medical dental hypnosis. I'm a registered hypnotherapist with General Hypnotherapy Council Register in UK. This is Hopeness. So I started doing therapies and hypnotherapy in my practice since 2015. I would be sharing in detail my first case, how I got into hypnotherapy and what was my experience of benefit that I received in my practice from hypnotherapy. But this is Hopeness. And while I was working with dental cases, a lot of things open up for people. You know, when people come to us, it's not just one patient who's coming to you for just one dental work. The entire one personality has one entire story within it. And a lot of things can open up with hypnotherapy, and your relationship with the your patient can be more like you almost become their therapist as well, because they share a lot of things with you about their lives because for dental visits, people keep visiting you over a period of years for many, many visits, and a certain rapport develops. And therapies happen automatically. That happens how best friends speak with each other, something similar to that. But Hopeness is our formal platform where we work on not just medical and dental issues, also emotional well-being. It could be anything related to mental, emotional, physical, financial, anything at all. Whatever's stressing out or whatever's overwhelming, any human condition for a person, we provide a very safe and a confidential problems if they have, or even just to enhance their potential and their personal skills. So this is Hopeness. So by definition, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, but it does get a little shaky sometimes. Your net.
इंटरनेट कनेक्शन लो है आपका, अगर ये बेटर हो सकता है तो. इंटरनेट कनेक्शन आपका स्लो है, आपका इंटरनेट ना।
The connection. Am I audible? I hope this is better.
Yeah, ma'am, it's okay now.
It's better?
Much better.
Okay. So hypnosis, by definition, is an altered state of consciousness and can occur naturally when you're totally absorbed in whatever you're doing. So hypnosis is a naturally occurring state. For example, you're really lost in a book and you're totally lost in the image. You can almost imagine and you feel like, you know, you're experiencing a really nice book and you become a part of it. Or like, you know, a movie that you totally become like, you know, totally engrossed. And so, you know, I see my mother sometimes, she's so lost in watching a TV serial that she starts nodding her head. And so hypnosis is naturally occurring. It could happen when you're driving. Sometimes you don't even realize from how you got from point A to point B because you're just driving on autopilot. So these are naturally occurring state, the altered consciousness. What we do with it. So hypnosis can be used for fun and magic and stage shows, or it can be just in clinical setting, how we doctors can use it. Hypnotherapy is a applied, very useful tool, which can be applied in many, many different ways to enhance patients' well-being. And we will get into greater detail with all these things as we go further. So this is all the Western documentation. A lot of papers were published, a lot of data is available, and hypnosis goes as old as 18th century. But what my personal belief is, and what I've read about the shamans in Native American shamans, they practice shamanism, which was similar to this. In India, we have the word sammohan and sammohit. In the Western literature, the word is mesmer and mesmerized. So I believe that, you know, we knew it. I think a lot of Osho meditations touch upon hypnosis. And so the oldest Western data, of course, the history is documented like that, that Mesmer was a person who was known to have a lot of, like, had medical application, but had a lot of fun with it. He would wear purple robes in Paris and do these hypnosis shows, but also worked with a lot of patients to relieve a lot of medical conditions, psychological and somatic pain. James Braid is the person who, so while Mesmer was practicing hypnosis, it was called mesmerism. The whole world knew hypnosis, yeah. So then James Braid is the Scottish surgeon who gave us the term later, hypnotism, which actually is derived from the word sleep, the god of sleep, from a Greek god named Hypnos. But I would say that it's sort of like a misnomer, the word itself, because hypnosis is not sleep. The patient is not sleep, the client is not sleeping. You can interact with them. Only how I like to explain is the conscious mind, the aware mind takes a back seat, and the subconscious mind, the deeper part of you, comes in front and is more open to suggestions. So James Braid gave us the term hypnotism, and then Pierre Janet took it forward, and then R.W. Sperry gave us the split mind work, and he won a Nobel Prize for that. Hypnosis got a lot of medical recognition, once it was used widely after World War II, after a lot of soldiers experienced post-traumatic stress disorder. So R.W. Sperry's work was used. He gave us the theory of the right brain and the left brain, like as we know that right brain is the creative brain and the left brain is the logical brain. Dave Ellman developed many techniques, Spiegel, and Erickson. So we will be using, and I will be talking about those their techniques in detail. How does hypnotherapy work? So hypnotherapy works on the subconscious part of a mind, which is 6,000 times more powerful than our conscious aware mind. So conscious aware mind is where all we assimilate data, we listen to people, we form judgments, we come to conclusions, we form judgments about ourselves and other people. And when we relax that critical part of the mind, where all the mind chatter comes from, and we get access to the subconscious brain, that's where the therapy happens. So as we go further, so this is the diagram by Dr. John Kappas, and it's called the Kappas-Sinanian model. As you can see in the diagram, there is critical mind. So the question called the conscious mind, the aware mind, which we're actually, if I would say that makes us like, you know, very arrogant or smug about the knowledge that we have, which is that is just 12% of the whole of our mind, where all the reason, logic, analysis happens. And like I was saying, the judgments happen. The critical filter is something that develops from 0 to 7 years of age as a child. And the blueprint of how we're going to function, how we're going to judge our value system is coming from there, which as we get older, gets more and more reinforced. And the subconscious mind, which is 6,000 times more powerful, is where all the experience that we've experienced in our lives are stored. We may not be consciously aware of those experiences all the time, but it's all in there. How, so if like, you know, when we are doing therapy, we can regress people back into subconscious mind and they can actually relive a moment like what were they wearing? What was the dress they were wearing? What was the shoes they were wearing? What was the color of the wall? What exactly happened? Who was laughing? Whose words were what? And what was the impact on yourself? So all the known experiences which we've ever lived are stored in the subconscious mind. It's like a very beautifully archived data system whenever we want to. So the therapists develop the tools or learn the tools to basically tap into the power of that memory and the subconscious mind. Primitive mind is that part of the mind which is formed at birth and also carries the basic primal responses like the fight and flight response. That's something we are like, you know, born with, the fight and flight. And also people who learn past life regression therapies, they say that, you know, all the past life memories are here as well. At this point, if anybody would like to ask me any questions.
Ma'am, generally we take the questions towards the end. They will be just posting the questions in the chat box. Okay. So, yeah. Whoever wants to ask will be, you know, putting in questions in the chat box and we can pick that up later. Because I don't see any question in the chat box.
Okay. So going forward, so inner child work and hypnodrama are two tools that I use mainly in my practice. So how inner child work happens is, let's say a person comes to me and has extreme fear of dentistry, or they feel anxiety and palpitations when they come to a dentist, or it could not be. So though I'm going to talk about hypnosis applied to dentistry and medicine, but a human being is a human being and it can be applied to multiple things about them. So inner child work is what I use very commonly. So let's say a patient comes to me and says that I feel this extreme anxiety whenever I am approaching a dentist or I see a dentist or I hear the sound of a drill, I just want to run away from there. So we believe anything that you're experiencing today started at some point in your life. So any excess fear, any excess anxiety is normally picked up from somewhere, either your own situation or a feeling, a non-verbal feeling or a fear that you pick up from one of your parents, friends or a sibling's experience also. So inner child work, when we are working, after we use the induction techniques, which I could be using an Erickson's technique or Ellman's technique, after I induce the person to hypnosis, then we basically regress them back to the moment of origin where it all started for them. So many a times I see that patient experience to an age like 7 and they're reliving an experience at a dentist office, or they're witnessing a sibling's experience in a dentist office. So inner child work works like this, that once they relive that entire experience, and we take the adult current day personality into the same level, and they experience that or witness the same experience from the adult's present day's view age as well. And once that all the dots join, oh, that moment, you know, oh, it happened that way. Oh, that is what happened to me at that time. So we make the adult version of you speak to the child version of you, the child part of you who experienced that trauma, and that trauma remained embedded in that person's mind. So once they reliving in itself is healing. Once the adult age of today understands what happened to them as a child, and then we make them join the dots, and we make the adult version speak to the child version and say, it's all over now. And I'm old enough and wise enough to take care of my oral health, or let's say medical health. And once those dots join, in my experience, I've seen that it becomes, if a person came with 10 on 10 fear or 10 on 10 anxiety, by the end of the session, they will have 3 or 4. And if we do further sessions with them, it goes down even further. So the other techniques, when it's really low, the level of anxiety or fear, we employ another technique called emotional freedom technique, which I would not be speaking about today, but anybody who's interested, they can get in touch with me later. So it's a Chinese technique, which involves tapping the points, the emotional freedom technique, and we can just bring the level of anxiety even further down to even 0. So they can go ahead with the procedure that they came in for. So the second thing I use a lot is called hypnodrama. So hypnodrama, let's say if the adult regresses to a childhood age into a traumatic experience, could be dental or could be anything. So we say that you can speak to, let's say the dentist was the child felt like the victim of the dentist or a doctor or a father or a mother in whatever the situation is. So it's like another version. So it's one offshoot of inner child work only, where we make the child speak or communicate, which the child could not speak at that point, at that age. We make that part of the child speak with the person, whoever they felt was violating them or were perpetrators or they felt victimized from, and they could not express at that age or that time because they did not have the expression or the wisdom when they were children. So we make that child of that part or that part of you that could not express at that time, in a way, complete the conversation and retaliate or express anger or mistrust or anything at all for that matter. That's called hypnodrama, enacting a situation where your expression was suppressed is a traumatizing experience for you. And by hypnodrama, we can address that and actually resolve the unsaid part. And once the client expresses freely whatever was traumatic for them, it's resolving for them. So within the session, we use the induction technique, do the inner child work, regress the person to that age where the traumatic event happened, and the origin of that anxiety that person is suffering today in a present day time, and then do the hypnodrama with the person who was involved with, or they were feeling angry with or unresolved with. We resolve that. Then we can end with a positive, suggestion. Or we can even ask the person to re-script or reframe. Now that's the really interesting part of the wonderful world of hypnosis. So the child may want to slap the dentist, push the dentist, or, you know, if they were clamping the child in the dental chair and continued the work forcibly. So we can ask them to, you know, like push everybody away and, you know, free themselves and liberate and empower, like, you know, so re-script or reframe that situation in an empowered way. So the child gets to communicate with the parent with what the child went through and feel supported and represented and reframe the entire experience into a positive one. So we sometimes use the tool in reframing. The adult day personality will enter now that dental surgery to take over the charge and make the child feel rescued or protected, which the child did not feel at that age. So this is like, it's called the new neural pathways are forming when you're reframing the whole situation. So when, as a result, when the client comes next time for a dental appointment, they feel way less anxiety or stress or fear or palpitations or whatever they were, the cluster of experience that was there, it becomes really less. And with progressive therapies, in my experience, if so, sometime a person can just get off it just in one session. Sometimes it could take 6 to 8 sessions to completely resolve. Sometimes there are multiple layers and multiple levels of experiences and the multiple incidents sometimes to resolve and heal.
Yeah, ma'am, I would like to ask something. Sure. Liberty of asking. So sure. This technique can actually be then even used in other sort of things like childbirth and all also, like hypnosis.
Yes, I will be touching upon that.
Okay.
I'll be touching about. So, you know, so I'm speaking a lot about dental, and but there is no, like I was, like, you know, I say hypnosis is a very underused but very powerful tool. Then once I'm speaking about medical, then I will come to hypnobirthing and variety of situations. And I would love it if all the doctors can give me their own situation and I can suggest how can they apply it to their practice. So hypnosis is still an underused but powerful non-pharmacological tool in dentistry. So there are absolutely no side effects. That's the most wonderful part of it. It involves no, so, you know, in UK, a lot of conscious sedation, the IV drug is used to calm the patient. So the patient is awake, but a drug is used intravenous. So whether it's general anesthesia or it's intravenous, it does come with whatever little bit of risk that is involved with it. So hypnosis is absolutely safe and harmless in a person who's trained properly in using, applying it in a clinical way. So I find it very useful to treat my patients. So the procedures I want to carry out. So I would like to share at this point that even before I learned hypnosis, I would always have compassion for the person who was feeling anxiety, or it was, I always say that always acknowledge the patient's feelings. If they say they are anxious, they're anxious. So a lot of doctors have the tendency, because of course they have very busy schedules and they have certain time limits set for a certain procedure. So they will just say, oh, get off it. Nothing is going to happen. It's not going to hurt you. It's not going to pain you. So just by saying if the patient could become calm, the patient would become calm, but that doesn't really happen. So my tip is, which I learned even before I learned hypnosis, is always acknowledge the patient's feelings. If they are feeling fearful, if they are anxious, if they're stressed or nervous, it is very real for them. Not patients, all patients are not alike. And this is a lovely platform to say that on, because all the doctors already are the holistic health doctors. So they know it's the patient as a whole. It's not just the tooth that I'm treating, but also the patient who comes to me and address the stress, acknowledge their fear, not brush it aside and say, nahi, nahi, kuch nahi hota. So that's the phrase that so instead of saying that, I say that I understand what you're going through, and I'll be very gentle, and I'll be, so I give them a lot of platform to share all their fears first. So the time I give them to share that in, and where I communicate and develop the rapport and the trust, eventually in long run saves me a lot of time with them. So investing that time in the beginning to connect with your patient, to understand their fears, anxiety, phobias, and stresses. So I had a patient who was a cancer survivor, and she'd come to me for her teeth, of course. And when I was resolving that, and I was just going with my regular procedures, we apply a local anesthesia gel before we give a shot. And I try to be as gentle as I can with all my patients. But she broke down and she said, "Doctor, I have had enough of doctors." So her experience was not just one experience in my surgery, but all the ordeal that she'd gone through with her cancer and her treatment. And she broke down and she was in tears.
Maharaj ji ko, ye iske andar Google hai, iske andar haldi hai, sont hai, iske andar aloe vera hai.
I would request the others to keep themselves on mute, please. Yes, Richana.
Yes. So Okay. So what I was talking about was that, you know, usually for the patient, the experience, whatever they're carrying is very, very real for them. And I begin by acknowledging it. And then we now that I have the tool for past 6 years, I always suggest that why don't you don't come to the dental surgery first and just meet for a hypnotherapy session first. So hypnotherapy can be used in multiple different ways. You can just use it just to relax a patient, depending on what the degree of the patient's nervousness or anxiety is, or a panic attack is. Let's say a person is experiencing extreme stress. They experience sweating, palpitations, and trembling of hands, and they're just not able to cooperate. So then I would use deeper modalities. But otherwise, for a lot of people who are just slightly stressed for the dentist, we can just use a relaxation technique, which is with guided imagery. So, you know, you can, after doing the induction methods, you can say that, you know, visualize yourself at a beach, feel the sea breeze. Each time you feel the sound of the dental drill, you feel calmer and calmer. So these are the positive suggestions that you could give to a person once they are, you already have the access to the subconscious mind and the critical filter is relaxed. So how therapies happen is the part I was explaining earlier, the conscious mind, and there is a critical filter in the center, and that is the subconscious mind. So if the person is not relaxed and they're very guarded in a situation like a dental practice or a medical practice, they're very guarded and not very open to suggestion. They're just coming from their own fear and they're totally psyching themselves more and more with their fear. And you don't have access to their subconscious mind at all, because that you will have once they're relaxed. So by using these techniques, by the reverse counting, by the guided imagery, you basically relax the critical filter, the judgment part. Otherwise, usi se takra ke sab wapas chal jayega, and all the methods that I'm trying to suggest, my positive suggestions, will be bounced back. Oh, and you know, all the mind chatter will begin. What would she say? Oh, she looks too young, and you know, oh, she will not know. Isko kya pata mujhe kya ho raha, and things like that. And you know, people have doubts. So once they are in a relaxed state, they become more perceptive to their ideas. And once the critical filter relaxes by using the methods that we use, we gain access to the subconscious mind and we can embed positive suggestions. Like you will find it easy now, like you will find the sound of the drill very calming. Each time you hear the sound of the drill, you'll be more and more calm. So that's the power of hypnosis that I would like to share with all of you. So in my experience, I apply it a lot for dental anxiety, needle phobia, a white coat syndrome. People can get triggers. These are all triggers. They see a needle, trigger. They see a dental instrument, gagging begins. They normally eat food and they will not gag, but if a dental suction or a drill goes in the mouth, they will begin they will feel the gagging. And so panic attacks, very common, and that panic attacks don't happen just in dental surgeries. Can happen in any kind of situation, real life situations, to a lot of people. And a lot of oral habits like thumb sucking, tongue sucking, nail biting, anything the parents want to work with. So I mean, though it's not dental, but in my hopeless portfolio, we always like to work with students, like, you know, who experience procrastination, or like, you know, we can enhance them to form goals and achievements. So not only we work on the negative things like oral habits, but we can also enhance positive behavior. In the medical situations, I will go through this, and I would love to talk about accident trauma healing a lot. So in medical applications, we can work on accident trauma healing. It could be surgical trauma, it could be a road trauma, it could, actually also grief or death of loss of a loved one also. We can work on unwanted habits, bedwetting, all types of stresses, headaches which are unexplained, all sorts of fears and phobias. We'll get into details of fear and phobia as well. Asthma, coughing, smoking, phantom pain is that, you know, the thing has been operated upon, a pain lingers which is unexplained. And the patient keeps on experiencing pain again and again, that limb. And the doctors will call it either psychosomatic or phantom. And so then the minute the doctor puts on the label of psychosomatic, that means we can't help you anymore. So hypnobirthing, of course, Dr. Bhatia was asking me, and we will get more into that if we have the time. Hypnobirthing, just in a nutshell, I would say that, you know, while a mother is experiencing birthing, if you relax her and use the similar techniques that I use in my dental surgery procedures, you can just ask her to experience the whole experience more positively. That you're now feeling that you're very relaxed, you're very calm, you're going to create life, and you know all the positive feelings. We can just, once the subconscious mind is open to suggestions, you can give any positive suggestion that you deem fit for your own patient. So that's hypnobirthing. And so you can even avoid, if they're anesthetists, they might want to argue with me, and I'm happy to argue with them later, that you can avoid epidural anesthesia if you're using hypnobirthing, which is a tried and tested method that I know the people are practicing in UK for sure, because I'm in touch with people. And if anybody, any gynecologist on board today or any anesthetist on board today, I mean, if they would want to experience, I'm very happy to teach. We do one-on-one programs in Delhi. If there's a larger group, I'm happy to travel to another city and, conduct these workshops. I would like to talk a little bit more about accident trauma healing. And hypnobirthing, we can always go back to later. Accident trauma healing, what happens is the person, let's say, experienced a roadside accident which was really severe in nature. So physically, we put back the patient. I was working in UK in Cambridge University Hospital, and we dealt with people who, if you're not wearing a seatbelt and the cars are at very high speed, they will smash their face on the windscreen. So you can put back the whole face together with plastic surgery. We can do the dental work. We give you new crowns and bridges. We can fix a patient, any broken bones. We use mini plating, jaw bones, body, anywhere in the body. So you rehabilitate by immobilization, fracture, the whole of that, do surgical procedures. But the emotional part of that trauma remains embedded in that person that goes unaddressed. And that is where hypnotherapy is a wonderful tool, where you can make them relive the experience. They could be even knocked out during that experience, that accident that happened. You can actually go back to the origin, make them experience that accident one last time and release all the trauma. So there are papers and scientific studies which say that all the trauma, the memory of a trauma gets, which is a very interesting concept, there's something called cellular memory. You know how old CDs were, the magnetic, the CDs drive jo hoti thi jaise, and you have data on that. Similarly, the cells of our body can also carry the data or the information or the experience, and that needs to be released for a complete healing. For example, a person stops driving after a bad accident because he's so emotionally traumatized. So the mental well-being and the emotional well-being goes unaddressed, though the patient can spend lakhs on a surgery. So I think by giving me this platform today, this is a wonderful platform where you always treat the patient as a whole. So it's a wonderful place to express this concern that I would love that, hypnotherapy is used mainstream, like it's used in many parts of the world, mainstream to use in rehabilitating the patient, where you can actually release the trauma that was experienced. So this is a very big topic where we can tell you how exactly, what are the methods and stuff we use, but let's go further. Generalized anxiety disorder. I've already actually spoken about it, but the anxiety disorder patients can experience nausea. They can experience GI symptoms, sweating, palpitations, extreme stress, fainting. That happens in dental surgeries. Can happen in other procedures also, minor procedures, or for example, in a medical situation, a hypochondriac patient can come with a lot of anxiety. So the doctor can sense it that it's not really, because the test won't confirm it, that there is nothing happening, but the patient is carrying a very fear. So to say, it's all in your mind, will not help the patient, because if they could get off it themselves, they would get off it. So if their conscious mind could understand with the reasoning, they would understand with the doctor's reasoning and a conversation. But the access to the subconscious mind, whatever that fear, the hypochondria or fear of a disease or fear of any type or stress of any type is coming from, can be addressed wonderfully using the hypnotherapy tools. So emotionally, a person can be stressed. And physical symptoms are, of course, I mentioned, like palpitations, sweating,
trembling, the emotional component of that would be nervousness, stress, and they can say, use a word like anxiety and worry. Now, this is the psychological or the emotional part of my presentation. Fear is fear of any type. It could be fear of loss. It could be fear of loss of a loved one. It could be a fear of rejection that we carry within us. These are various fears which can sabotage our lives and our emotional or mental well-being. And so fear of success. So many a times you'll see a top-notch executive right at the brink of a big promotion, all of a sudden will develop a serious health condition, which the doctors are not even able to understand. They run all the tests, everything seems all right, but he will experience some physical symptom. So where all this fails, all the tests, I don't know if it's arrogant or smug to say that, but I would at least like to be considered, I would like to suggest something and be considered. I believe that modern medicine ends, all the medicines and the investigations end, and doctors are perplexed that why is this case not resolving? Everything seems all right. That's where the hypnotherapy begins. Because let's say a person who's the brink of success is sabotaging their own success by coming to you with physical symptoms. Basically, somewhere deep within, he believes you are good for nothing. My father said when I was 4 years of age. They carry that belief in their subconscious mind that I'm good for nothing. My father said that. So right at the brink of success, that person could become an alcoholic, could develop a physical ailment, which is beyond the understanding of a doctor. And when the doctors say it's psychosomatic, that's where a hypnotherapist can be employed. So not everybody has to learn hypnotherapy because of course doctors are in their own mainstream work. But if they know about hypnotherapy, they can ask a hypnotherapist to come and intervene. That is what the holistic component would be. So treating your patients by taking into account whatever they're carrying within themselves mentally and emotionally, and they could be carrying all of this. So, you know, we can resolve at multiple levels. And so conscious counseling by a clinical psychotherapist, hypnotherapist can help you work on the subconscious mind, and the doctor can, of course, treat the presenting symptoms. It could be physical rehab. So I would use that. This is like a mental or emotional rehab part that we totally miss in our practices. So the fear can be of many, many types. I've listed a few, but there are many more types of fear. Each person is unique and their experiences are unique, and they carry their own unique fears also. But fear of pain is very common when patients are coming to doctors, and fear of exposure, fear of stranger. And right now, of course, we're dealing with fear of exposure, COVID. COVID in the pandemic was such a huge fear, causing all kind of anxiety. Fear of strangers, fear of responsibility, taking on too much responsibility. The minute too much responsibility comes on, the people will come and present with physical symptoms which are very vague. And the doctors don't really understand. They can't really get a diagnosis. So they can consider all these things that it's the patient carrying a lot of other things within them which are giving them physical symptoms. And of course, the fear of the unknown, that is common too. So different between fear and phobias. Fear is something more commonly, in my experience, picked up with a childhood experience or something that happened in the past, and that is what that led to it. Or you could pick up it's a family of let's say hypochondria. The mother is hypochondriac, the child is hypochondriac. So it's within the family, the child is picking up from the mother. Phobias is something that's more unexplained. So, somebody is just have this extreme fear of flying who's not even taken a flight. Or somebody is really fearful of drowning in water. They've not even really lived by the sea. So all these phobias, again, can be addressed with hypnosis. It can be explored when it started for them. And once in hypnotherapy, you take the person to the origin where it started from. That's exactly where you put the light on and diffuse and heal that experience for that client. And that person feels, in my experience, lots of relief. If anything, any of these fears or phobia, are they sabotaging their lives? For a person who loves to travel but has fear of flying, it's sabotaging their lives. Or for a person who needs to travel for their work and they have fear of flying, it's sabotaging their career. So if these things can, this powerful non-pharmacological tool with no side effects can help. So I just urge that, people use it more and more widely And so if anybody in their practice would like to be connected to hypnotherapists, I know lots and lots of hypnotherapists within your own cities that, you know, I could connect you with.
Ma'am, can we use this hypnotherapy for children who have attention deficit disorder or they're hyperactive?
Coming to the limitation of hypnosis, I would like to share that as well. Of course, all modalities have their own limitation. So hypnosis involves a concentration or a focus. So if a child is not able to focus, then hypnosis may not be possible. Because hypnosis is a form of concentration. Like I was saying, the natural trance states occur when you're reading a book and you're totally lost in it. So you're very concentrated in the book. If somebody is watching TV and totally absorbed, glued to that TV, the word glued is used, right? The glued to the TV and totally absorbed, that's concentration. So this is a form of concentration, and a child who's not able to concentrate and there is attention deficit. So that is one of the few conditions where it cannot be used. So there, of course, there are other modalities. There are many other modalities like CBT, EFT, the many things that which other things which can be used.
Yes.
Lot of grounding, there are a lot of grounding techniques which can be used.
Right.
This is sort of a bit of a repetition of what I said earlier. So whenever a person is experiencing any type of pain, there's an emotional component of it and there are physical symptoms of it. So the emotional could be anxiety, fear, phobia, panic attacks. Panic attacks is something really severe the patient experiences. They feel that it's the end of the world. It's doom. I don't know what to do. And they just feel that, you know, they are so overwhelmed with that situation. It's like almost like fight or flight kind of thing. So I have treated a person in Malta, who was experiencing a lot of panic attacks. And then after the 6 sessions or something, he reported that, you know, it's very, very minimal. So the sweating or the thing, the pacing, it was really affecting his career. Because he would have panic attacks in his board meetings and stuff, and he was holding a senior office. And so in my experience, hypnotherapy can really help something as severe as panic attacks. Otherwise, so the drugs are always the last option. Going to a psychiatrist and popping medicines, of course, if the option is there. If hypnotherapy fails, that can be tried, but there's no harm in trying hypnotherapy first because it's so non-invasive. And the physical symptoms, of course, I've said before, palpitations, sweating, fainting, breathlessness, dizziness, rise of BP. So I would like to add before I get into this, that in state of hypnosis, all the palpitations, what you, when your patient is experiencing, they're in a hypnotic state, the breathing becomes very relaxed, the eyes roll up, and your head might tilt to one side. And if you put the pulse oximeter on, the pulse is really nice and stable and low. So if they were experiencing palpitation, breathlessness, none of that exists. So while they're in a hypnotic state, the conscious mind has not gone off to sleep. The conscious part has taken a back seat. Subconscious mind, critical filter is relaxed. That person is not judging me. Oh, that needle is coming. Oh, that hurting me. All of that and mind chatter has stopped in the hypnotic state. And so that's the most useful aspect of the mind chatter stops, and you can make positive suggestions. You can get cooperation from the patient. The pulse is really low and stable. There are no physical symptoms. They can follow instructions. They're not completely sleeping. It's sort of, that is why it's different from sleep. So the hypnotism word comes from sleep, but it's not really sleep. It's an aware kind of state where you're actually listening to the doctor's instructions. You're following it. Your critical filter is relaxed. They're not judging me. They're not judging the experience. And I'm able to give them positive suggestion. And they're very relaxed. And all the physical symptoms they were feeling, the high BP, the high whatever, the pulse rate, everything is relaxed. And the breathing is very calm and very steady. And during this time, a guided imagery is an adjunct, where you can say, now you're in, what is your favorite spot? Go to your favorite holiday spot. And somebody could choose like a mountain spot or a beach spot, and they can experience, they can be by the beach while they're experiencing the minor surgery. This is another part of the thing, that it's in continuation with the emotional well-being work that I do. 5 stages of loss a person can experience. So loss can be anything. It could be extreme financial loss. It could be a pain of a breakup, emotional bond. It could be divorce. It could be separation from children. It could be death of a loved one. And so these are the stages a person goes through. First, they are in denial. Then, it's the other way around. The stages are different. So denial, and then first is depression, sorry. The first stage is depression. You feel really low about it, and something has hit you and you're grieving. And then you somehow go into denial and then anger. And then you form some compensatory method. You reason with yourself and somehow come to terms with it. That's how they say time heals. So the time taken on your own when you are dealing with a personal loss is longer when you go through all these stages of depression, denial, anger, and then bargaining, and then finally resolution. So time heals, and that could be a long time. And during that time, it could impact your work and your other relationships when you're dealing with loss. So this is a hypnotherapy, again, is a very useful tool which can help people deal with loss. And this journey of recovering and feeling better is much shorter. This is, now I'll talk about, we go to the earlier slide. Thanks. How hypnotherapy chose me is my personal story. It touches upon my spiritual journey. So how it began for me, hypnotherapy work, I came across medical and dental hypnosis when I was still working in UK in the Addenbrooke's Cambridge University Hospital. And there was a study day that was conducted that spoke about medical and dental hypnosis. That was 1999. And it did intrigue me a lot. It was just a one-day thing. And I was like, wow. And everything they shared and everything, I was like, wow, that's possible. That sounds so wonderful. So that's the time that spark happened. And then all along over a period of years, it was not pursuing anything. I just came to know about it in 99. And then I started choosing books. I read books by Brian Weiss, Many Lives, Many Masters. And the subject always intrigued me. And I read more and more and I kept reading. But 6-7 years ago, I was going through my own personal crisis. And it was a very stressful personal situation for me. And I canceled 18 appointments of my practice that day. And I didn't show up at work. Now, work has been the center of my life. Me not going to work means something is seriously wrong with me. And so one of my friends suggested that, why don't I go to his therapist? And of course, your intellectual mind tells you I can deal with everything. That's coming from the conscious mind that I don't want to share with people. I'm a private person. I don't want to go and cry in front of another person. What is my problem? I'll deal with it. But the dysfunction of canceling 18 patients that day. So I was dealing with something for a while. And my friend was telling me for a while to go to a therapist and experience therapy. And I was in denial or whatever mode or whatever. But when I had to cancel work and it impacted work, I woke up. And then I realized I need to do something about it. Because it's extremely embarrassing that 18 people in a day have planned that, you know, they're going to make time, organize drivers and show up at your practice and you don't show up and cancel them last minute. That was, I experienced my first therapy. And so after my therapy session, I was like so relieved with whatever I was dealing with. I could go back to work the next day. And I said, wow, this is amazing. I need to learn this. This was 2015. And then my journey with therapy and learning therapy and the therapy journey eventually led to meditation. My teacher, Umi Dutt, she's my therapy teacher as well as she teaches meditation. And so everything I would say that, you know, this world of therapies and working so closely with human beings and you see so much suffering and everything, you just require your own grounding. And if you meditate, your therapies reach another level only, I feel. It really enhances my work. So that's how the spiritual path happened alongside my work. And so I would share my first case with you, that is my first case of hypnotherapy, how it started. So there was this lady from Bangalore and referred to me by a friend. And she was the person who experienced extreme, extreme anxiety. She was 50 years of age. She knew she was in bad oral condition. She intellectually, consciously, she was a very intelligent, educated person. She knew she had to take care of herself, but it was beyond her to show up at a dentist clinic. She said, I will make appointments and cancel last minute. I will reach the dental office and take a U-turn and go back home. And I just cannot make it to a dental office. That's how high her situation was. And so usually when people come at the practice and they're stressed, over a period of time, I had developed my own method without the hypnotherapy, and I could calm my patients down and win their trust and, you know, execute treatment for them. But this particular person would not even show up, right? So how to treat that person? So anyways, I suggested that though I know about dental hypnosis, and I don't do hypnotherapy. So my patient had never experienced anything hypnotherapy. I had never done any hypnotherapy on a patient. But by that time, I had experienced a therapy on me because of my own personal experiences. So I asked that hypnotherapist to come to my clinic and induce my patient with the techniques that she used into the hypnotic state. And then I was, to my extreme surprise and delight, execute 8 procedures on her that Sunday morning. So we only called her that day. We didn't schedule any other patients, and we called the hypnotherapist. So she took 30 to 40 minutes to induce her by using the modality. And then I was able to, so she was able to follow my instructions. She was not sleeping and dozing off because she had to keep her mouth open. Otherwise, how would I work? So she was able to keep her mouth open, follow all the instructions that I was saying, and was could cooperate more than a normal regular patient who's not even anxious. That was such an experience for me. I was like, wow, I was able to do 8 procedures for her. My patient did not experience dental fatigue. Normally patients get tired in 45 minutes. I worked for 3-4 hours. I completed a lot of work for her. And then of course we got her back to alert state, which is very easy. In the end, you just say, now when you open your eyes, you'll feel very alert and awake, in touch with your surroundings, and the hypnosis ends. It's as easy to guide them out of it. So a lot of people, of course, there's so much myth around hypnotherapy. People come to me, hypnotherapy, I don't know what you're going to do to me and what will I do? And, you know, they have all kinds of things. But as a therapeutic tool in good hands, you can do so many useful things with it and educate your patients also the benefit of it. So that patient now, I mean, she's given us a wonderful testimonial. It should be on my website. And so not only she can get dental treatment done from me, she can go anywhere in Bangalore to any dentist. She is free from her anxiety and fear. So that's my first case, which then I decided to learn it. Then I did that. Then I studied at ECHA. Then I studied at ASO. Then I went to UK to learn, because I'm a believer of this process. And I'm so thankful to all of you to give me the platform to speak about this today. These are some of the patient testimonials. And I'm open to questions. How are we on time?
We have time, ma'am. We have, say, half an hour.
So I'll be, I think from 12 o'clock something, I will take the questions now.
Yeah,
then we can get into.
There are certain questions on, if people can, if they're open to speaking also, you can just raise your hands. We can unmute you, or you can just type your question on the chat box. It was so, so wonderful, ma'am. I wish I had met you earlier. I've been through so many root canals, and it's been an ordeal, you know, going to the dentist and just that thing going in the head, you know, that someone is drilling inside your mouth is so, I mean, so scary. I totally wish I had known you earlier. Now I know where to
can educate other people.
Yeah.
So, you know, Dr. Bhatia, I do teach hypnosis, dental hypnosis. And I mean, like, I would love to work with any of doctors who would like to work. Like I said, you know, I can do smaller groups in the clinic. I can address bigger groups. Whenever you feel that you have any community of doctors, which, you know, they can benefit from, I would love to teach all the doctors. Yeah.
Lovely, lovely.
So we have an academy called Academy of Dental and Medical Hypnosis. Okay. And we'll be happy to share the details with you.
Beautiful.
I see a hand, a raise of hand.
Yeah, it's Mr. Rasho. I'm just asking him to unmute himself. I think he can do that now. Sir, you can unmute yourself.
I've done it. Hello.
हाँ जी आप बोलिए सुन रहे
हैं जरा what I want to know how children memory children intelligence can be developed with the help of this hypnotherapy if small talk small knowledge small idea small tips
sir please repeat your question again
for children in the age of 10-12 years who can understand who are school going or college going into how their how with the help of hypnotherapy their intelligence can be how parents can be helpful to develop their intelligence their development and their growth for education overall life prospects
so okay.
That is the most tender age and I am inquiring this question for my grandson who are based in abroad where this hypnotherapy is available
and they are
very 13 years old
so what you can do is depending on see each child is unique each child's issues are unique. Some children have habit of procrastination. Sometimes they have habit difficulty in concentration. They're distracted. These days, there's so many distractions, and the focus can be shifted from the goals. So when you do when you use hypnotherapy, we can give positive suggestions, which could. It's a unique script that you write for each child. So for example, a child has issues like. A test exam anxiety that you know they feel stressed before exams, or it could be any issue at all. But the method remains the same. So you use the hypnotic techniques, you relax the child, and you speak to the subconscious mind in a very nice, positive whispers. Like now you will be able to find, you know, you will whenever you have tests, you will prepare well in time. You'll find it easy to be, you'll find it easy to plan your schedule, plan your time. Be ready or prepared for your exam in time. When you're going for your exam, you feel very calm and collected and confident. You will be able to recall easily. So a unique script is written for each child. And because the subconscious mind is open and receptive to receive these positive ideas, we can embed these positive ideas and new neural pathways form. So all the old belief system or the old habits go away, and you see a positive shift in the child's behavior. But it requires multiple sessions, like, you know, maybe 4-5 sessions to see the shift to change. But they begin to feel some benefit immediately.
How parents come to know that he needs this hypnotherapy treatment and all that? How that is my query.
Only parents. They only need to visit only if they feel that there is a positive talent, they have the capability, and they would want to enhance it. They can visit a hypnotherapist. That, you know, the child is very good at singing but very shy at performing, for example. He's very good at speaking but shy to go on stage. So anything that's stopping them from achieving their best potential, the parent can seek a therapist. You can use a therapist to resolve negative issues and also enhance positive attributes.
Thank you very much.
Screen, you can stop the screen share so that if the screen work is done, we can.
Yes. Not a seasoned speaker on Zoom. Huh? Better on one-on-one teaching, I am.
Yeah. So, ma'am, it was actually wonderful. It's so comforting when, you know, doctors are now not treating the body just like a body, but they do, you know, take the mind and the soul also with it, and a holistic approach. So it's actually very, very comforting. And here, most of the doctors are all spiritual doctors who are using all these techniques already. And, you know, obviously the learning never ends. We are learning new techniques, you know, every single day like that. So it's actually been lovely. I don't see any other questions as such. Ma'am, you can lead the group to meditation then.
Before I get into the meditation part, I would like to really thank you again, because I just really, really like the whole concept of your forum. And it was so nice of Dr. Gagan to invite me to speak here. This is the forum that, you know, I'm speaking in, because I get to tell the doctors, like, you know, this is one more, how they can be more holistic in their approach. And I would also like to thank, like I said, I would like to thank all my teachers one more time, And my family, my mother and father, who've had unconditional support in all the quirky, offbeat things that I wanted to do. I would like to say thank you to Dr. Sia, please, Dr. Sia. She is my tech support. I have like major technical technology phobia, and she helps me do all my presentations. And without her, I could not hold my fort here. And I would like to thank, she's been a wonderful associate to me, and I really depend on her. And thank you to all of you again for being a wonderful audience to me. Thank you.
Dr. Richa, it was a wonderful session with you.
I know where to take my kids now, because I myself have been always so scared of going to a dentist. So.
Dr. There's a question here.
Yeah, there's a question in the chat. One question. How can we control child's anger?
Yeah. Yeah, let's address that. Okay, that's Vinita ji, right? Okay. Anger, again, like I said, you know, once you are able to, firstly, the child should be aware that, made aware that how, on the moment when he's not angry, make them aware that what anger is doing to them. It's an unpleasant feeling in the body that you feel. The person who's angry also goes through a certain set of physical things, and it's not a very pleasant experience. So when on a normal day, on a normal moment, when he's not angry and things like that, the suggestion can be made to seek a therapist and what it can do for them. And, you know, because it's so addressing the child that whatever's unpleasant for you, we can help you deal with that, because the child has to show up. He has to want and seek the therapy. And then it's therapist's job to earn the trust. So all of that needs to happen before we can actually work with the child. The child has to want it and show up. And the therapist has to come down and have a lot of compassion. And absolutely, it's your safe platform where we don't judge by saying, oh, you get angry. And it's not a negative trait at all. You get to know the child. You get to know the child's personality. And what are the situations which trigger him to be angry? So you need to spend that time to understand what is triggering the child and what situations lead to what reaction. And then, of course, like, you know, once you develop the square of trust between the therapist and the child, brilliant therapies happen. And we can, of course, like their methods, again, like I said, you know, all you have to do is use those simple hypnotic tools in any situation and basically give positive suggestions to the mind, which can be, the script can be made in cooperation with the parent. We can give the positive, and the parent can even be in the room. It's like some people have that concern that, oh, like, you know, my child is going to experience hypnotherapy. I don't want my child to experience hypnotherapy. The parent can be there in the room for the child. I hope that's answered the question. If you want to ask me anything else, Vinita ji.
Richa ma'am, you have a string of validations. Everyone has been, they've really enjoyed this session.
Happy to know.
Yeah. So I think it's time for meditation now. We'll have, say, about 15 minutes, 20 minutes. Look forward to that. EFT ma'am, even I would just like to share, we have used EFT on many of our meditation sessions. And it actually helps.
Yes.
Yeah. It even helps while you're doing it, you know, like when you're leading people into EFT, it helps you yourself also.